I'm foolish, or maybe I'm blind, thinking I can see through this and see what's behind. Got no way to prove it, so maybe I'm lying. But I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put your blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Take a look in the mirror, and what do you see? Do you see it clearer, or are you deceived in what you believe? 'Cause I'm only human after all. And you're only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me. Some people got the real problems. Some people out of love. Some people think I can solve them.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ben. I'm from Ogden Avalanche. Welcome to tonight's presentation. Tonight, we are talking about what's in your pack, what's worth the weight, and what isn't. For those of you that don't know, Ogden Avalanche is basically run on 100% donations from community members and businesses. So this Tuesday, we are doing a Giving Tuesday fundraising campaign. You'll see that information on our social media. Please go to our website if you can and donate. That's ogdenavalanche.org. For every $10 that you donate, you will be entered for a chance to win in one of those three prizes you'll see on our social media. Also, if you haven't already, go to Mountain Luxury and like our post there as well for a chance to help us with some fundraising to keep presentations like this going for you. All right, it looks like we're about to get started. If you guys have any questions as we're going, please put them in the chat. We'll talk about them after. It'll take me just a second to get this presentation set up, and then we'll start from there. Thank you guys all very much for coming, and we'll see you on the other end. All right, for tonight's presentation, we're going to be talking about what's in your pack, what's worth the weight, and what isn't. So let's start with the minimalist, right? We all know those folks that all they carry is a probe, a shovel, they're wearing some skin-tight lycra, they maybe have 500 milliliters of water, and a pocket full of goo shots. These folks are really trying to move fast in the backcountry, and they're more focused on that lightweight, fast movement. Versus we have the overnighter, right? This is somebody that's on an expedition or a walkabout in the backcountry. They're going to have with them anywhere from a tent, sleeping bag, sleeping pad. They might even have a full spice kit so that everyone can spice their own food. They're going to have a toothbrush, toothpaste. They're even going to have some floss. They might have everything to make hot toddies or a nightcap. They'll probably have a flask, maybe a breakfast beer for the morning, and they're going to have a hatchet. But really, these folks are kind of on that expedition level where they're going to have a lot of equipment to spend an extended time in the backcountry. But most of us are going to be in this third category, and that third category is going to be the happy medium. The happy medium, in order to find the right space of where we're going to be, we're going to have to match a few different things. And that's going to be match the location of where we're going to be. Are we going to be in the Ogden Mountains versus are we going to somewhere like Stanley, Idaho, where it's going to be a lot colder there? Maybe we're headed to the Tetons. What's our objective? Are we going to ski peaks? Are we going to ski powder? We need to make sure that we have the things specifically for that. And then you want to match your body. Right? A couple of years ago, we had a class that we were teaching, an Avalanche 1 class, and we had a student that was really worried about being cold. The high projected for the next day was about 5 degrees, and it was going to be a little bit windy that day. She was really concerned about being cold as we were standing around teaching snow pits. So she decided that she was going to bring everything she needed to be warm. She showed up with an average size or a normal size pack from the looks of it. And in that pack, she had a huge set of mittens, a giant puffy coat, some puffy pants, and a set of bibs to go over her softshell pants, over her puffy pants, and then just kind of block the wind as she was standing there in the snow pit. So she was knowing her body and knowing that she was going to get really, really cold standing there, not moving on this cold, windy day, which was amazing. You would have never known as she just kept pulling stuff out of this pack. But she had decided that day to match the weather conditions to her body and dress extra, extra warm that day for standing around. Next, we want to match our caloric needs, right? Some of us are heavy snackers. Some of us barely eat in the backcountry. But you want to make sure that your caloric needs are everything that's normal for you. And then you always want to have a little extra to get you out of a pinch. And then matching your gear or your gear repair needs for the specific objective and the specific location, whether that's going to mean you're bringing ski crampons or maybe even an ice axe, harness, rope, or it means that you get to leave something else home because you're not going that far. Make sure that you have all of these, and that's having all of the essentials. I don't think that there's a perfect kit for every single type of tour. The perfect kit is going to be to find this happy medium and match that location, the objective, and your body for what you're trying to do. So here's my example of what the essentials are. This is my pack kind of exploded out. This is what I'll carry on most days, whether I'm teaching avalanche courses or skiing with my friends. First off, the industry is going to tell you you should carry an airbag pack. Airbag packs, the statistics supporting them are great as far as keeping you on top of the snow if you're in an avalanche. However, here's my two cents on that. It's more important that you have the avoidance, right, and education portion that goes to that. A lot of folks that wear these avalanche airbag packs take unnecessary risk because they're wearing that pack and they view that as kind of a safety net or a safety veil. You want to make sure that you're not exposing yourself to unnecessary risk or unnecessary hazard simply because you're wearing that extra piece of safety equipment. Think of it the same as the beacon. You don't want to go into an area where you wouldn't be wearing a beacon anyway. Same thing with your airbag pack. You don't want to jump into an area that you normally wouldn't ski just because you have that airbag pack. A lot of folks in the Northern Wasatch, when they die or there is a fatality for an avalanche, a lot of the time it's going to be trauma-based. So keep that in mind, that the airbag may protect you from staying on top of the snow, but it's not going to protect you in the event of trauma. We need to have a snow safety kit, probe, shovel, maybe even a snow saw. Your warmth or your layers, right? You want to make sure that you can add or subtract depending on the day or as conditions change throughout the day. You're going to need a first aid kit. You're going to need a repair kit. Food and water, depending on your needs specifically. And then a headlamp. This is kind of going to go in my It Hit the Fan cleanup kit. Usually I don't like to ski with a headlamp unless it's for a dawn patrol or dusk patrol, but those are rare these days. So my headlamp rarely comes out unless it's with It Hit the Fan kit. So you should also have some navigation, whether that's a map and compass and a phone. I like to put them kind of as map and compass and phone, because if you're in an area you're unfamiliar with and your phone dies, you don't have anything. So that map and compass, along with the ability to use it, is really important. Some sort of communication, whether that's a phone, a PLB, or a personal locator beacon, or some radios. And then some extra room for skins, helmet, layers, maybe extra food, whatever you need. So in the snow safety and study kits, right? First item here as the snow safety, we're going to put a beacon in here. That's not going to go in the pack. That's going to go on your body after you've already done the function checks. You're going to make sure the battery life is good and you're going to make sure that it's working. And then you're going to head into the backcountry. With that, you want to make sure you have a probe and shovel, not a plastic one. It needs to be a metal blade. Avalanche debris could have ice. It could have limbs. It could have rocks. It could have a lot of things in it. It needs to be a metal shovel. A snow saw. I would highly recommend that if you get a snow saw or you are carrying a snow saw, it's also capable of cutting wood so that you can cut firewood, cut a splint or cut a litter if you need, if something else went wrong. It's kind of a dual piece of equipment there. And then let's talk about snow study kits. What's in them? I consider it a luxury in my pack, right? If I'm carrying that, it's something that's it's an extra for me. It's not just the normal pack. And then do you need one? So first off, a snow study kit is going to have everything you need if you're kind of digging pits and really getting into the snow science, or what I like to call snow nerding or snerding out. So when you're snerding out, you might need one of these snow safety kits. Just the average user really isn't going to benefit from having popsicle sticks, thermometers, and a sawed-off paintbrush that you can see here. What you might enjoy having in your kit there is an ID card or even just a small lens, something really lightweight that you don't really need too much to get into. A lot of times when people are digging these pits, this is a PSA, not a rant, people are digging these pits to confirm like, oh, I dug a pit, now I can ski the big line. But that's not how digging pits works. Digging pits is going to be to confirm what the report was saying is out there is actually out there and you're still seeing it. If you're not seeing it, you should suspect that that's an isolated area that you're not seeing it. Something to note and report later as we kind of figure this out. But just because you dug a pit doesn't mean like, oh, I dug a pit, I'm going to send the big line. Just something to keep in mind. As we're talking about warmth, right, or layers, you want a pack for your body. You want a pack for the objective of what you're trying to do. And again, you want a pack for the location. Depending on where you're at, you may need two puffies, or you might need a puffy, a wind layer, and a shell. It really just depends. The day can change too, right? If you're checking the forecast and it looks like it's going to be really cold that day, maybe throw in your extra puffy or your mid puffy. Mittens. I'm the worst for gloves. I know that for me personally, this is one of my body things. I like to use a leather glove. I don't know why specifically, I just do better in leather gloves. So I'll carry three pairs of gloves, just a leather set of work gloves covered in a beeswax. And then I have a mid insulated work glove or leather glove. And then I have my big mittens. But for me, my mittens are kind of one of my luxury items. There, if things get really cold and I'm really uncomfortable, I pull them out and they always make me happy and I'm glad I've carried that extra weight. Those are one to me that are always worth the extra weight is my big thick mittens. A hat or a buff, whether this is a baseball hat on top of a beanie or vice versa, you do your baseball hat and then put your beanie over it. Or if you have a buff that you add a little extra warmth there. And here's one that a lot of people don't think of is switching from your sunglasses over to your goggles. Once you switch, kind of those goggles can add a lot of warmth, and then throwing your helmet plus those goggles, that can really help add warmth there. As we talk about first aid kits, I like to break mine up into three areas. That's a trauma section, a preventative section, and a pain section. So in that trauma section, I'm gonna have stuff to stop a major bleed, some absorbent pads or ABD pads. If you don't have ABD pads or you don't wanna use them, feminine hygiene pads work great as well. They're very absorbent and they're easy to stick on. And then you can tape them on or use a ski strap to secure them, add pressure to stop a bleed. Splinting material, I usually have my shovel handle, my probe, stuff like that. I'm not going to carry around specific splinting material. And then I have my two kind of essential first aid pieces, and that's going to be my survival bivy or rescue sled. Some of these will come together, some of them won't. For me, I have a rescue sled that doubles as a bivy that also doubles as a two-person survival shelter. If somebody is hurt bad in the backcountry, most likely a severe trauma or a broken leg or something like that, they're not going to be getting out on their own power. Getting them out on an improvised sled where you don't have material to wrap them in, they're going to be soaking wet. They're going to be covered full of snow, and really it's going to be a miserable experience for you and for them as you're trying to get them out there. So these sleds are designed for this. They really help, and I think it's well worth the weight, and they are quite heavy for some of these rescue sleds, up to 2.5 pounds, 3 pounds, but I think they're worth every ounce of weight, especially when it comes to the times you actually have to use them. Next is the preventative. First off, with a blister kit, this is my most common used first aid item, is blister stuff. If I turn on my laser here, you can see these little blisto packs. They work amazing. You can get them at CVS. Band-Aid brand also has them, but they're like a silicone cushion, and they really just do a great job for preventing blisters once you kind of have a hot spot or something like that. They don't work great after you already have a blister. The next would be some baby powder or some Body Glide. These are great for chafing, especially on warmer days, or people that have overdressed. A lot of beginners have some issues with chafing, and most of the time that's they're getting too hot, sweating too much. The other preventatives I like, I really like to carry chapstick and sunscreen. I think they're a great idea to have. As far as pain meds, I mostly carry over-the-counter stuff. Some people will have some narcotics left over from a surgery or something like that they'll carry. My only caveat on carrying narcotics or giving people narcotics is, one, you shouldn't be giving people drugs that are yours. If they're not their drugs, they shouldn't be taking them. And second is, you have to be careful if you are going to take this person out and they're going to get definitive care later. If they're going into surgery or something like that, you need to make sure to let the first responders know they've been taking narcotics so they don't overdose them or it doesn't cause a complication in surgery later. As far as other meds go, I have kind of a day med kit and an overnight med kit. Turn my laser back on here. My overnight med kit here will have some Benadryl, some ibuprofen, a couple of Dayquil in case someone starts to feel a flu or a cold coming on. And then also in there, I'm going to have like an antidiarrheal and those Tums in case somebody has an upset stomach. But I don't carry a whole lot as far as drugs go other than that. Turn off my laser and next slide. So now we're talking about repair kits, right? Repair kits are notorious for having way too much or way too little in them. Really, when I start with my repair kit, I want to start with things that are going to work for my specific bindings, my specific boots, my specific poles and bags. And what I mean by that is that your screwdriver is going to fit your specific gear. A lot of the time, this skiing equipment will use a very specialized Allen key or a Torx head, the kind of star head keys. You want to make sure that it's designed to fit your specific equipment, so you don't get out in the field and have the screwdriver with 10 pieces on it and none of them actually fit what you're trying to do. I really like to carry extra screws for my equipment, especially my bindings and boots. You can usually pick these up pretty cheap and they're light, do a ton of stuff there. Wire, in case you really have to just kind of rig something to get out. I also carry skin and ski wax. Most of the time I'm just carrying actual ski wax and I'll use that on my skins as well. In this picture, I have just my skin wax out as well. A multi-tool is a great option. They can be heavy, but they can be worth the weight as far as all of the tools they have. A knife, pliers, a saw, a leather punch, a can opener, all those things can come in handy if you're on a gear trip or if you're out, you know, a lot of tools can come in handy there. Ski straps. This is another one in my repair kit. I think you can't have enough. I put at least three here. I usually have one around each pole, one around my rescue sled, and one or two floating around in my pack somewhere at all times. I think they're a great tool. Duct tape. You can roll that around a popsicle stick, or you can just make your own little roll, and then super glue. I found these individually wrapped super glue single-use containers that are awesome. And they've come in handy quite a few times. I also carry some spare batteries in this pack, a little bit of P-cord, and then this is some UV cure epoxy. It's made for fly fishing or fishing waders, and it has come in handy to repair packs or pants in the past. I really have liked having it. I also carry an extra pin for a split board when I'm working, and this is going to be a little extra P-tex and a scraper. Rarely are you going to use that P-Tex. That's mostly if I'm at the yurt and somebody hits a rock or something like that. So talking about food and water, some people are heavy on the snacks. Other people eat a big lunch. It's important to know what your group is going to do. If they're going to stop and eat a big lunch and you think you're going to get cold during that lunch, you're going to want to prepare for that with the layers that you bring. Also, if you're going for a really big tour, make sure that you have enough calories to meet your personal needs and then a little extra in case somebody drops their sandwich or forgets their sandwich in the car. Also, sometimes, you know, you just feel maybe you're using a little more energy than normal. You want to make sure you have enough calories to get through the day. How much water to bring? For me, I want to say everyone should bring at least a liter. I know that some people won't even drink a full liter in a big, long tour. Some people will drink 2, if not 3 liters. The only caveat here for how much water is make sure that your water is in a container that even if it starts to freeze, you can still get it out. Whether that's a Nalgene, one of those HydroPack water bottles that are made out of silicone. Really with a Camelback is where you want to be careful. I see a lot of my beginning students in Camelbacks and they can't get their water because it's frozen and they don't have another way to drink it without pouring it down the front of them as they're trying to drink out of the main fill up from the Camelback. So just keep that in mind. And then we have that if it hits the fan cleanup kit. This is going to start with my headlamp. Next is going to be a wag bag. A wag bag is a sanitary waste, human waste bag, in which if you have to do number 2 in the backcountry, you use this bag. It's full of some enzymes and some powders that will neutralize any liquid or anything like that so that you can have your number 2, throw it into your pack, and it's safe in your pack. It's not going to spill anywhere, and then pack that out. Now, I realize that some people aren't going to use a wag bag in the backcountry. So if you're not going to use a wag bag, please, please look up the leave no trace principles and follow those principles in the backcountry. Please don't take a number 2 just right off the trail or right off the skin track or near a water source that's going to be used in the summer. Make sure that you're packing this out. And if you're not going to pack it out, please at least pack out your paper and your wipes. A great way to do that is use a 1 gallon Ziploc with some hand washing wipes or these wet one wipes in it, and then a 1 quart bag that you can put those in to pack them out and throw them away when you get home. I know no one likes to use the number 2 in the backcountry, but if you're going to do it, please be responsible. The next thing is something to start a fire. This should usually be a lighter or some waterproof matches in a waterproof container. Also included in here is a fire starter. This is going to be part of your survival pack. A lot of my survival pack also includes my rescue sled. And for me, it's an in-reach. Whether for you, that's a spot, a ham radio, a cell phone. Just make sure that it's going to work for what you're trying to do. As far as fire goes, I just want to hit on that one more time. Make sure you have something that can start a fire, even if there is ice or snow or water on the fuel source that you're going to find, whether that's down trees or broken branches. Just know that sometimes in the winter it can be hard to start a fire, and that's where one of those fire starters that burns for a long time, even if it's wet or even if it's the wind is blowing, might really come in handy for that. And then we have a few luxury items. You don't have to carry these, but they're kind of nice, and I think they're worth the extra weight. For me, I really think a thermos full of hot tea or hot coffee is definitely worth the extra weight. It's a nice little pick-me-up, and it'll warm you from the inside. A small foam pad, maybe a Summit beer, Summit whiskey, some extra clothes. If your buddy's going, you can always wow them with some cold chicken tenders. They seem to like that. It's always a hit. My wife loves her down skirt. She can slide this on over her boots and it adds a ton of warmth for a quick lunch or if she's just getting chilly in general. If we're going to dig a pit, she's standing around. But she'll use that kind of a lot. Sometimes she even skis down in it as it is really just a warm layer, kind of a puffy coat for her waist. And then for me, if it's really cold out, I like to carry some neoprene boot warmers. Most touring boots are really lightweight and don't have a ton of insulation. And so if it's a really cold day, my feet tend to get cold. I wear those neoprene boot warmers. So no matter what you do, you want to find a system that works for you. And to do that, you want to focus on the essentials, match your gear, match your needs, and match the objective. You can see in this photo on the left, this objective is a multi-day hot trip. So we have big packs and this big sled. This big sled doesn't have a lot of weight in it. It's mostly food or sleeping bags, pillows, down booties, stuff that's pretty lightweight but kind of bulky and wouldn't fit in our pack. So again, that's a multi-day hot trip. This is going to look a lot different if you're going for a morning tour at Snow Basin Or maybe you're trying to do a two-night, three-day Ogden Skyline overnight trip where you're going to go starting at Pine View, go all the way up to Lewis Peak, then come down, hit Chili Peak, Ben Lomond Peak, Willard Peak, and have somebody pick you up down in Manaway, right? Your pack is going to look a lot different than that morning snow basin tour, or from the left, this hut or yurt trip. A couple things I like to do is make these kits. So these are easy throw-in kits, right? You can have an overnight kit. It's one dry bag that has your pad, your sleeping bag, your pillow, your shelter, maybe your extra socks, all in one little bag. It's not big. It's easy to throw in. You know where it fits in your pack. I think those are great. Then we have the long drive kit. This is something that's kind of nice. These are more like car kits or overnight kits, just something to add. This is if someone forgets their skins, maybe has some extra food or water. The Bluey, everyone knows, with a 7-gallon water jug that just lives in the back of your car in the summer, the Bluey. Or we have a wine bag. This is a just-in-case bag. It's going to have extra TP and wipes, extra repair stuff. It's going to maybe have extra set of poles, extra set of skins, some splints, some warm stuff, usually an extra bag of coffee or something like that, some snacks. But really, this is like a bag that you'd leave at the hut or the yurt just in case. So we want to make sure that we organize our packs accordingly. A lot of packs are going to have snow safety compartments that are going to hold your probe, your shovel, your saw, anything like that. So you want to utilize the pack as much as possible. The next thing I like to do is use these individual little bags. So it'll go from a blown up pack like this into an organized pack like this. It allows you to get your frequently used items off the top quickly and easily. Using these bags to make these kits, you know what you're grabbing and what's in that kit. I also like to use a dry bag for my puffy. We talked about using the pack specific pockets for your avalanche stuff or your goggles, stuff like that. And the last thing is, I just want to hit on this, is items that are not securely inside your pack are not going to be yours for very long. They're just kind of waiting to be reclaimed by nature and lost to the outdoors. So keep that in mind, especially with snow safety equipment, probes and shovels, those need to be inside of packs, securely fastened inside of those packs so they don't fall out. Otherwise, it's a matter of time before they're reclaimed. So thank you all for joining us. I really appreciate it. For those that have been following along, just a little season update. Our last presentation was on snow and avalanche journaling. So if you've been following kind of what's going on, we had some snow that came in. And then until then, we've been kind of high and dry, right? The snow's just sitting there rotting away or faceting or getting weaker. So look out for that as that next storm shows up. No storm really on the horizon, at least for the next week. So kind of keep an eye on that. But when the snow starts to fly, really, really watch this faceted layer and track that to make sure you're not setting up the season. We do have a fundraising campaign coming Giving Tuesday. That's this coming Tuesday. If you can, please make a donation. You can do that through our website, ogdenavalanche.org. That'll keep free presentations like this one going. Also some of our beacon clinics. If you want to sign up for a class, you can go to our website and sign up for one of those Backcountry Basics 101, or you can look at our shop there, buy yourself a hat or buy one for someone for Christmas. That would be great. That helps support us as well. And you can also find our upcoming events there. If you have any questions, please send an email to ben@ogdenavalanche.org or Corey, that's Corey with a K, K-O-R-Y @ogdenavalanche.org. And we hope to see you guys in the next presentation. Thanks. And if you have any questions, please leave them in the chat. Okay, everyone, thanks for joining us. We're going to go ahead and give you guys a minute or two to ask some questions in the chat while we play some music. If you guys have any ideas of courses you want to see coming up in the future, put them in the chat as well. Our next kind of courses that we're going to be looking at are a terrain management course coming up, and then also a backcountry first aid, but more so how to work with search and rescue and how to get help or get out of the backcountry. So thank you all very much, and we'll go ahead and put some music on, let you guys ask some questions, and we'll be back in a bit.
I'm only human after all. I'm only human after all. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put the blame on me. I'm only human. I do what I can. I'm just a man. I do what I can. Don't put the blame on me. Don't put your blame on me.
Okay, looks like we don't have any questions, so thank you all for tuning in, and we will see you with our next set of presentations. We'll probably start somewhere in late December, if not January, with those. Those are going to be our next set, so until then, thank you guys very much. Oh, looks like we might have one right here from Brandon Long. What's my favorite touring pack? Well, I think that, again, we're talking about location and objective. But for me, my main pack, I use a Black Diamond Cirque in the 45 liter. I'd really like to use an airbag pack for more stuff. They are a little bit heavier and they do cost a little more. But for me, I really like that Black Diamond Cirque. All right. Looks like that's it for the night. Thank you guys all very much and have a great night. We'll see you in our next presentation. Don't forget about Giving Tuesday. If you can or are able to donate, that'd be great. Thank you very much.